invitation to come here. It's now almost exactly 2 years since my last visit to this city. And I'm glad to be back. When I was asked to lead the opening devotional sessions for the 2 days of the conference that we have together, I immediately thought of the letter of Paul to the Galatians. There were a number of obvious reasons for this. First of all, Paul's letter to the Galatians was probably the most the book that he most frequently taught when he was in the University of Edinburgh. He went to it back to it at least 3 times, and arguably the finest commentary that he wrote was his commentary on the Epistle to the Galatians. So Galatians meant a lot to Luther. He had reflected upon it a good deal. And in fact, I would suggest to you that Galatians was the book that was the catalyst to the change in his thinking that led to the what we know as the Reformation. So it's my intention briefly to look at a couple of passages in Galatians, one today and one tomorrow. Today I want to look especially at chapter 2, verses 14 to 21. So if you can have the text of Galatians 2, 14 to 21 in front of you, that will be helpful, because it will save me having to refer back specifically to the passage. You can read it for yourself. It's my intention to look at these passages primarily through Luther's own eyes. Now that creates something of a problem for us. Luther's context, quite obviously, is not our own. That's true in terms of time. It was 500 years ago, allegedly last Tuesday, 500 years ago that he nailed his theses to Wittenberg Cathedral door. But I think it's equally obvious that it's not only a question of time, but it is a question of setting. Luther was applying his understanding of the Word of God to the Western Church context in which he had been nurtured. For the most part, those of us who are gathered here today gather from the context of the Eastern Church. Thus, for example, the Armenian Apostolic Church has charted its own course for well over a millennium and a half. The Orthodox Churches, though formally separated from the Western Church in 1054, were already looking very different from their Western brothers and sisters before the schism. Luther's application of Galatians to the Western Church, therefore, may not be obviously applicable to our own context, certainly not in precisely the same way. It is, however, my conviction that Luther raised issues in the application of Galatians that ought to shape our response, largely as Protestants and Evangelicals, to the prevailing church context in which we are called to serve. So I'm going to attempt to read Galatians through Luther's eyes, as though he were viewing the situation in the Eastern Church. I hope I succeed, at least to some degree. But first of all, a brief reminder of the background. The Acts of the Apostles does not provide us with much information about Paul's ministry in Galatia. Paul is first mentioned as having visited the region in chapter 16 and verse 6 of Acts, and to have returned to strengthen the disciples there in chapter 18 and verse 23. This implies, or so it seems to me, a possibly brief church planting initiative on his first visit, followed by a second visit in which he was nurturing the churches that he had established. What happened next is spelled out in our epistle. As so often in church history, a group of visiting preachers claiming a special authority, the authority of the apostles, arrived to supplement, as they viewed it, Paul's teaching. Doubtless Paul had done the best, they would have thought, but his teaching was inadequate. It was not the full story. The false teachers then were intent, they claimed, to putting the matters right, to filling in the bits that Luther, that Paul had left out. Now, Paul's response runs along a couple of lines. He emphasizes that while his calling was directly from God, it had been accepted by the apostles. And he emphasizes that in Galatians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10. Not only so, but when Peter and Barnabas and others had been attempted to adopt the view that the false teachers had now brought to Galatia, Paul had to point out to Peter and his colleagues very firmly that they were in the wrong. You find that in chapter 2, verses 11 to 14. So the implication is that they had accepted that rebuke. Finally, Paul stresses, as he had done to the Jerusalem church, that a gospel plus is actually a gospel minus, or worse still, no gospel at all. So that's the general context. What was the specific issue? Well, the passage that we're looking at this morning, chapter 2, verses 14 to 21, indicates that it was the relationship between the Old Covenant, which Paul refers to as the law, and the New Covenant, which Paul here calls faith in Jesus Christ. Fundamental to Paul's view is the view that the Old Covenant is provisional and preparatory. We see that especially in chapter 3, verse 24, where Paul describes the law as a school teacher or a guardian providing the necessary preparatory framework for Christ's ministry. For Paul and Luther, this relationship appears to be a threefold one. First of all, lying behind the present passage is the conviction articulated in Romans chapter 7 and verse 12 that the law, especially in its moral demands, is holy. The law is a transcript of God's own perfection. That's point one. Point two, the law is secondly the standard by which we are called to live. But a standard which fallen human beings cannot possibly hope to meet. Simply says Paul, by the works of the law, no one will be justified. That's chapter 2, verse 16. Consequently, and thirdly, the law functions for Paul and for Luther to condemn human self-justification. And so it is in verse 19 that Paul says, "For through the law I died to the law." But this is its purpose. Righteousness through the law is simply impossible. It always was. Only by, quote, faith in Jesus Christ. And notice how often that phrase occurs in the passage that we're looking at together. Only through faith, by faith in Jesus Christ, can anyone be brought into a living relationship with God. Now, very profoundly, this relegates the law to Jewish customs, which is what Paul says of them in chapter 2 and verse 14. And Luther makes much of this. Paul does not condemn the practices of the law in and of themselves. He would, in fact, circumcise Timothy, as we read in Acts chapter 16 and verses 1 to 3. However, such customs should not be imposed on others, those whom Paul calls the Gentiles in chapter 2 and verse 14. They cannot be imposed on others as though they were essential to their being part of the new covenant people of God. Indeed, and this is the crux of Paul's argument, to do so, to insist on the works of the law as supplementing faith in Jesus Christ, would suggest that actions by human beings were required to complete an individual's salvation. And that is the key point for Paul in this passage in Galatians. Now, Paul here is speaking in what we might call shorthand terms. He's speaking here briefly of things he addresses more fully elsewhere. And critical to the understanding of his argument is his comment in chapter 2, verse 21, where he says, "If righteousness could be obtained by the law, Christ died for nothing." For Paul, therefore, a right standing with God is dependent wholly upon Christ's atoning work on the cross. Now, those who've studied what is known as soteriology will know that there are various theories of the atonement, not all of which are mutually exclusive or contradictory. However, Paul emphasizes Jesus' death here and elsewhere in this letter. And it's difficult to escape the conclusion, and here we do stand with Luther, that Paul views the atonement as Christ's penal, substitutionary sacrifice for hopeless, helpless, and lost sinners. Put simply, the righteousness God requires of human beings is unattainable. More seriously, the failure to meet such a standard places sinful humanity under God's anger and judgment. Only by Christ's self-sacrificing of himself as a sinless human being in place of a sinful humanity can the penalty of sin, which is death, be met. Human beings, Paul is arguing, can do nothing to get right with God. Only by humbly looking to him through faith can the fractured relationship be re-established. Now elsewhere, interestingly, Paul will note that even faith is a manifestation of divine grace. Thus in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 9, Paul comments, "It is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast." It is, I think, interesting that Martin Luther and some of the leading Luther scholars considered that Luther's greatest book was the one entitled The Bondage of the Will. In it, Luther taught that while the will may be free by nature, it is everywhere in bondage to sin. Thus, the will is only once again genuinely free when it has been given life in the context of a living relationship with God by His Spirit. Now, consequently, and I think our study tomorrow will address this more fully, our lives after grace through faith are the life of the indwelling Christ. Paul says in verse 20 of chapter 2 of Galatians, "The life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God." It is the empowering presence of Christ by His Spirit that alone performs in us what a Scottish theologian once, by the name of Henry Scougal, once called the life of God in the soul of man. So, to Luther and to contemporary application. Luther had taken seriously the pursuit of a relationship with God. He had sought to do this as an Augustinian canon in Wittenberg, and even undertaken the demanding pilgrimage to Rome. However, he had found no peace for his conscience. Indeed, rather like Gregory of Narek, Augustine of Hippo, and many others of the church fathers from East and West, he had come to the point where he was painfully aware of the impossibility of satisfactorily meeting God's high calling. And it was in this darkness that Paul's letters spoke to him. He discovered it was not what he, Luther, did, but what Christ had done for him that was all important. All else was rubbish. Any other message was, in Paul's words, accursed. No gospel at all. And when Luther was incapable of even stretching out his hand to God, the grace of God gave life to his imprisoned will and enabled him to embrace Christ. And in that empowering embrace, find his heart beating with the beat of his Saviour, imperfectly enabling him to live a divine life. But this was not the Christianity he had been taught or received. And so, like Paul, who stood alone before the apostles, Luther stood before the might of the Western Church, certainly in the early days, with a sense of very profound loneliness. Thus, and I here am going to largely use Luther's words, Luther says Peter's crime had been his dissimulation and his infirmity, which had threatened the liberty and truth of the gospel. The problem lay in the belief that in some way what Luther calls the individual's active righteousness was required. Peter and Barnabas and their friends had come in some way to believe that active righteousness had a part to play in a person's salvation. However, says Luther, in the face of, quote, human weakness, end quote, what was required was what he calls a passive righteousness, where, and again I quote him, we work nothing, render nothing, but only receive and suffer another to work for us. That's the end of the quote. This, says Luther, is the righteousness of faith. Now, while Luther realized belief in the need for, quote, active righteousness is deeply rooted in us, he describes it as evil. Pastorally, and spoke of the battles of his own heart, he said, quote, the afflicted and troubled conscience has no remedy against desperation and eternal death unless it take hold of the promise of grace freely offered in Christ. This passive righteousness of faith, or Christian righteousness. End of quote. But he goes on to comment, quote, I abandon myself from all active righteousness to receive this heavenly righteousness given of us of God without our works or our deservings. End of quote. If Luther is thus profoundly aware of human inability through sin, what he calls with all the flesh, Luther knows that this is true both before and subsequent to faith. We continue to live in the flesh. This will become an important point in our second study, but here it's mentioned simply to emphasize that active righteousness is neither a grant for real prior to faith, in Luther's view, nor is it possible as a means of remaining in God's favor subsequent to faith. There is no gospel blast. The flesh is still a curse, but the Spirit reigns, rejoices, and is saved by this passive and Christian righteousness. And that last phrase is again from Luther. In a particularly wonderful passage, Luther says this, do we work nothing for the obtaining of this righteousness? I answer, nothing at all. For the nature of righteousness is to know and believe this only, that Christ is gone to the Father and is not now seen, that he sits in heaven at the right hand of his Father, not as judge, but made unto us by God wisdom, righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Briefly, that he is our high priest, entreating for us, and reigning over us and in us by grace. Here no sin is perceived, no terror or remorse of conscience is felt, for in this heavenly righteousness, sin can have no place. There can be no anguish of conscience, no fear of heaviness. The Western Church in Luther's day was filled full with the means appointed to secure active righteousness. While Luther would not necessarily regard some such activities as bad in themselves, they had come to be used and interpreted as the actions by which righteousness could be achieved. In this context, a vast penitential system had been devised to make good personal lapses by active righteousness. Almsgiving, pilgrimages, the intercession of the saints, masses, the list was endless and controlled by the church. Luther believed that the entire fabric of church practice seemed to be built upon the assumption that active righteousness was needed to supplement the work of Christ. This, however, represented for Luther what he called the Babylonian captivity of the church, which is the title of one of his most famous books. Or to put it another way, Luther's view was that the Roman Church of his day was once again revisiting the Galatian heresy. But what about us here today? Most of us are Protestants. Many of us are Evangelicals. And as such, we identify ourselves as Luther's descendants. Yet few of us, I would suggest, have as profound a recognition of sin and of the flesh as Luther did. Luther realized that sin has extended its corrupting influences to the deepest levels of the human psyche. Minds, hearts, and wills, Luther insisted, are captive to a power of the flesh, from which there is simply no escape. Active righteousness is, therefore, from Luther's point of view, a complete and utter non-starter. Even faith is a divine gift, and that faith looks and can look nowhere else but to Christ. In another passage, Luther says this, and this is wonderful pastoral theology, quote, "The devil is inclined in our affliction and a conflict of conscience by the law to make us afraid, and to lay against us the guilt of our sin, our wicked life past, the wrath and judgment of God, hell and eternal death, that by means, this means he may drive us to desperation, make us his slaves, and pluck us from Christ, however he says, to know passive righteousness is freedom. All the petty and hopeless means we employ to get God on side are swept away in the embrace of Christ's own righteousness." Now I mention this because some of us, I am sure, need to grasp the sheer munificent grace of God in Christ. And I say that to those of you who may well carry the label Protestant and even Evangelical. We need to grasp the sheer munificent grace of God to us. When I used to teach, one of the things I used to do very often with my students when they first came up was to teach them that everything was dependent upon God's grace. Because it was surprising how many students coming from an evangelical background still thought they had to do something to win God's favor. They had not fully grasped that the only favor that we can ever win with God is by faith in Christ. And that's liberating us, as I recognize. And if you have understood that, don't forget it. Don't forget it. But finally, the Eastern Church, like the Western at its best, is not wholly unaware of what Luther emphasized. And I would suggest that there are, at this point, potential bridgeheads for us in our interactions with one another across the different Christian traditions. There are points of contact. However, the Eastern emphasis on the autonomous freedom of the will is, in my view, at best unhealthy. Thus, while it emphasizes the necessity of divine grace, this is often somehow contingent upon the human will. And that emphasis can, certainly in popular orthodoxy, become another form of active righteousness. The Christology too of the Western Church, of the Eastern Church, is different from the Western. This helps, I think, explain the emphasis placed in the Eastern Church upon Easter Sunday, whereas in the Western Church, both Catholic and Protestant, the emphasis is placed upon Good Friday. Of course, the Eastern Church is highly sacramental, and the sacramental life of the Eastern Church has as its heart the liturgy, the sacrifice of Christ. However, attending the liturgy can itself descend into a form of active righteousness or some form of grace boost, rather than the means by which the passive righteousness of Christ is received afresh and his fellowship enjoyed. And it's at those two points, I think, that some interesting dialogue could take place between the Protestant and Evangelical Western Church and Eastern Orthodox churches. I will conclude with quoting an English hymn writer by a man. man by the name of Augustus Toplady. And he wrote these words that I think Luther and I believe Paul would be able to endorse. Toplady wrote this: "Not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no rest find now? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Saviour, or I die." Toplady was of course persuaded that this was indeed what Christ had done for him. And at that point he found profound peace in his conscience. Righteousness was not about him. It never is. It is all about Christ. And this Luther and Paul before him saw with a clarity which I think we all need to learn.